Hi, my name is Luna Penn, and welcome to today's Composer to Composer interview, brought by the Australian Guild of Screen Composers. Today we welcome Australian composer Helena Czajka. After graduating from Sydney Conservatorium of Music, Helena moved to Tokyo to work as an orchestrator for a well-known composer, Yoshihiro. Since returning to Australia, she has composed music for projects such as Blind Ambition, which won the Audience Choice Award at Tribeca Film Festival in 2021, and the Emmy Award-winning children's animation show Bluey, the award-winning series Revelation, and all seven seasons of Australian Survivor. In today's video, we'll be talking about two projects that she recently worked on, Unseen Skies and Blind Ambition. We will be discussing her creative approach to the film and her working relationship with the filmmakers. Hello, Helena. Welcome to this episode of Composer to Composer interview. How are you?
Great. Thanks so much for having me. It's exciting.
Yeah, very honored to interview you this time. So let's have a brief talk about how we met.
Well, I think we met at a APRA Screen Music Awards.
Yeah, that's right. Back in 2018.
Yeah, right. Yep. Met there. It's a great place to kind of meet people. So I hope we get a real one soon in person because I miss them. It's so great. It's the one opportunity we all get to kind of get together as composers, hey?
For sure. I mean, yeah, it's been a pleasure knowing you, just seeing all the achievement you've been doing over the years. It's just incredible. It's incredible.
Thank you, Luna. Thank you.
Perhaps we can talk about how did you start, and you mentioned that you were working as a composer's assistant in Japan before all this.
I went to the Sydney Conservatorium of Music, studied composition. While I was doing that, I actually worked as Guy Gross's assistant, who was heading up the guild for a period of time. And that was a really great learning experience for me, just being around film and music and how they combine. And then after I finished my degree, I went over to Japan. I had an amazing kind of virtuoso violinist who went to the con, was living over there. So I met up with him and he introduced me to a film composer over there called Yoshihiro Ike. And he needed an orchestrator at the time. So I said, no, I can probably extend my stay. And I ended up staying for a year and working as his orchestrator. And it was a really great learning curve and a really interesting experience. Being in a totally different country where I couldn't speak the language. We communicated through music, so we got by.
Wow. I was about to say, did you have to communicate in Japanese and like...
No, music.
Okay. Wow. Wow. That's incredible.
He could speak a little bit of English better than I could speak Japanese, so we got by. But it was amazing. And he was kind of composing on a different project every 2 weeks almost, a new feature film. So the volume of work we were getting through was humongous, and we were going in and recording orchestras every month or so. So just kind of having that kind of around at all times was a great way to learn the ropes, I guess.
Yeah, I'm sure it's an incredible experience, and definitely also in Japan experience and culture, I'm sure.
Yeah.
The composer was doing some animation work as well.
In terms of music over there and even like film music, it was a very different, kind of very different way of composing really to what I was used to in the culture here. And, even in terms of like the way that things were orchestrated, I found was very different to what I had learned, you know. There was actually like a real preference for this particular composer, at least for higher frequencies, higher range kind of instruments. So where typically in the orchestration that I had been used to, you'd kind of put a lot of bass in there and you'd have, you know, your big tubas and things playing kind of that bed. He didn't want that. He wanted it to be really high, a lot of like really intricate, beautiful rhythms and things, which was really fun to work with. And then I kind of got back here and started writing again and realized that I kind of had to change the way that I wrote again because it just didn't apply for the, you know, what people wanted in an Australian context. But yeah, I mean, learning all of that is kind of, you know, I think it makes you a kind of richer composer at the end of the day to understand how different people compose. So
for sure. Yeah, sounds like a very valuable experience.
Mm.
Yeah, and now you've been, so you got three feature films premiering at the same time at Sydney Film Festival, and congratulations on this. Yeah, so thank you so much for giving us the permission to show the work that you've done. So today we've got Unseen Skies. Yeah, would you like to talk about the project?
So Unseen Skies is a feature documentary that follows an American artist who's most well known for his photography work. And he's got a real interest in kind of government surveillance and data collection and all these kind of scary things that are happening behind the scenes. And it follows him as he, with his most recent project called Orbital Reflector, tries to launch this 30-meter artwork up into space. And journalist and director Yara Boumelham, who's fantastic, follows him on this journey, which doesn't always go to plan, and explores some really interesting kind of and scary things regarding AI and surveillance and stuff along the way. So yeah, it was a really interesting concept and story, and yeah, pleasure to be a part of.
Yeah, amazing. So without further ado, let's take a look.
The smart one. It's like almost like too much because that sliver of light that's still in the frame. So I'm making these photographs, and then what I'll do is make the negatives, develop them, have those scanned so they'll have really high resolution digital files, and then we'll take those files and take them into this software environment that we developed in the studio that allows us to draw what different computer vision algorithms see when they look at an image, whether that's lines or faces or, you know, what have you. You know, just kind of show ways of seeing, and ways of seeing are never neutral. There's always forms of power inherent in those ways of seeing. This landscape's just amazing. If we think about a figure like Muybridge, who is learning how to see faster than anybody had seen before. We all know the iconic image of the horse.
How about that? That was amazing. Just love the gritty electronic sound. Yeah, and the tone of the film. So how did you come across Yaron? How was your working relationship like?
I'd worked with the producer of the film before on a couple of other projects, Revelation, which was a three-part series on ABC, and a few other things years ago as well. I've been working with him for a while, so he introduced me to Yara, and I feel like we clicked pretty early on. She had a fantastic editor called Francisco Forbes, who was brought out from Spain to edit this film, and he loved music, and I think his background was in music videos, cutting music videos. So music was everything to him. And he wanted to talk to me very early on. Yara and him had some really interesting music references that we kind of started playing with. They loved how William Baczynski and Johan Johansson would kind of take acoustic sounds and warp them and make them sound really weird. And that kind of related to the film and the whole thing of, you know, things aren't quite as they seem. And then also the electronic kind of world as well, like Cluster and Aphex Twin. And we were playing with a whole lot of really interesting stuff. And then Frank, the editor, had just mentioned kind of offhand that he knew that NASA had this huge library of sounds that they'd recorded in space. And it just kind of was a bit of a light bulb moment for us. And I thought, gosh, wouldn't it be amazing if we could get access to that library of sounds and use them to form, you know, the samples that then we're able to create music out of. So the film producer already had a good relationship with NASA. They were being engaged for various reasons to do with the documentary. So I asked if he wouldn't mind asking if we could use those samples as well. They thankfully said yes, and we got this huge library of hundreds of sounds, and going through them, they were just really interesting, and they each had their own kind of quality about them, whether it was just like an atmosphere or radio waves kind of captured on one of the planets, or vibrations captured from a moon. And they kind of took on a kind of a musical aspect, you know, like some of them sounded like bass synths, some of them sounded like rhythms, or that I knew I could kind of splice up into rhythms, and some of them sounded like melodic little motifs. So I started kind of dividing them up into different folders, and then went through a process with Yara and with Frank, the editor, of experimenting with them and working out what we could do with them to kind of craft these kind of weird sounds into music. So that scene that you heard, a lot of those rhythmic elements were created out of these samples that I had access to. And then, you know, in other, I think also in there was a lot of modulation happening. There's a theme that goes do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. And that was just a rhythm that kind of went da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. I think it was like a Morse Cody type thing. And it was just a matter of kind of pitching that to create this little kind of wave motif in there. And yeah, played a lot with filters, a lot of flanges, a lot of, you know, what else did I use? A lot of sidechain, kind of, phases, kind of just anything that was going to change what it was, which is just like a sound that's like a zzz into something rhythmic or something melodic.
Should we have a listen to the samples individually and sort of talk about the process of how you put them together?
Yeah, so I've given you just three of the hundreds of samples that I had. I thought I'd give you three that we could listen to. I'll tell you what I did to them, and then we can have a listen to an excerpt of one of the cues that has all three of them in there so that we can hear how they all came together.
Even that has so many layers and so much stories.
And it's got a bit of a pulse to it as well. You can hear it's like a fluttering in the background. And I heard that and I thought, so to start with, that is an electromagnetic hiss that was recorded from Saturn's moon and called Enceladus. And I then applied like a flanger automation to it. which took the kind of, it's like a noise, yeah, and then I created like a rhythm. Yeah, so it then becomes like a in the music, which created like the rhythmic bed of this cue that I'll play you. So this instantly sounds like a bass synth, like a yeah, droney kind of swell. So with this one, it already sounded great. So it was just about splicing it up and changing the pitch to suit the cue.
Wow. It's so fascinating how much sound and music the universe can make.
I know, yeah. Just chuck a microphone anywhere and you'll pick something up. That's good.
Yeah. Here we go, the Sputnik beep.
So Sputnik beep is very famous. People recognize it, you know, world over. So I wanted to incorporate this into a few different cues and in the hope that some people might recognize it. In this particular cue, I changed the pitch of it, which I think is a bit sacrilege. I don't think you're supposed to do that, but I needed to in order to fit it into this cue.
So this excerpt will incorporate all the three samples that we just heard. Wow, there's just so many layers of synths and the samples, and you can't tell them apart.
Yeah, and that was kind of the idea, just kind of create this, you know, try to create a score that sounds like it's kind of made up of real musical kind of samples, and at the same time kind of try to blend sound design with music so that you don't really know what is part of the atmosphere that's being created on screen and what's part of the music, which I love where, you know, sound design and music kind of link up. And you know, like I find working with sound designers really interesting, and wherever possible, often on projects, I try to ask, you know, the sound recordist who was on set or the sound designer in post to send me as much kind of source recordings as possible. And if I'm able to integrate it into the film, I like to do so.
So just listening to the score, I thought it was quite bold and edgy, and it has that suspense building. And how was that, was that mostly from communicating with the director on creativity? Was she kind of open to all kinds of ideas, or was she more like more specific about some kind of aspects?
She was kind of the perfect balance of kind of knowing what she wanted. She knew that she wanted it dark, edgy, unlike a traditional film score, and kind of almost, you know, a sound installation that supports this incredible artist and his work as well. So that's kind of where we went with it. But at the same time, she was very open and trusting of the process and really, you know, I threw in some very wacky ideas and she didn't go running for the hills. She embraced them and one-upped me a lot of the time with more crazy ideas. And, you know, her and Frank, the editor, who was very involved too early on particularly, their brief was pretty kind of specifically unconventional. And I really like that. It's very rare that I get to work on something like that. Being in the art music world, which I haven't been in for quite some time. It's nice to be working on something that's kind of, I can explore kind of sounds in a different way.
Yeah, it's so unconventional and there's so much creativity involved. And yeah, I guess that's when magic happens and that's when something new happens. Yeah.
Totally. Yeah. But you really need the right project to explore that stuff. I feel like I just got really lucky that
this one is perfect. It's about the space and you hear space. Yeah. Coming up next, we're talking about another feature film that Helena scored called Blind Ambition. Helena, would you like to have a description of the project?
Sure. So Blind Ambition is a beautiful feature doco about these four Zimbabwean refugees who fled to South Africa and became sommeliers in some of South Africa's top restaurants and formed a Zimbabwean team, the first ever Zimbabwean team to compete in the World Blind Wine Tasting Championships in Bordeaux in France. And it's this beautiful story, you know, that this wine tasting championships is like the Olympics of wine tasting. And the skill level, it's like you know, it's tasting a glass of wine and being able to tell what year and from where and what type of wine and from what grapes it's all from. I learned a lot by doing this film about wine.
You're just going to have very sensitive taste buds.
Yeah, I know. I don't think I'm quite there yet. I'm trying. It's just this beautiful story of these guys who, you know, are kind of entering this world that is typically a very European kind of, you know, highbrow kind of world. And these guys just bring this incredible energy to this culture of wine tasting. And I guess, you know, it's a really uplifting, great story. It's so much fun to watch. And it was, really, really great one to be a part of. It's premiering at Sydney Film Festival for Australia, but it premiered worldwide at Tribeca Film Festival in New York in June, and it won the Audience Award for Best Feature Documentary there. So that was a really great kind of win for the team. Unfortunately, none of us could be there because of COVID, but it was good news anyway.
Yeah, I'm sure it will do just as well at Sydney Film Festival.
I hope so.
Yeah, shall we take a look?
Sure.
I told you.
I remember well my very first sip of wine, and I didn't like it. So this is actually one of the finest Sauvignon Blanc we have. It's quite refreshing, crispy, very good for lunch, but more gooseberries, tropical fruits coming through with the balance acidity.
Most foreigners are looking for jobs in restaurants. They ask you about what kind of wines do you know. I only knew red and white.
Every time I could see other waiters opening bottles of wine, it was very fascinating. Like, oh, wine. Must be nice, eh? I drank it a little bit. And then I got sick for 2 days.
I was raised in a Pentecostal church. Alcohol is not allowed. Chenin, Chardonnay. But at the same time, the first miracle that Jesus did was to change water to wine.
We're the only one who knows our story. You know, you try to explain it to someone else, they won't understand you. Looking in my life and where I've come from and where I've been, I think I actually do believe in destiny very, very much.
That's a very interesting topic and a very interesting feature film to work on, I believe.
Yeah, no, it was really great and kind of, you know, learning about, you know, Zimbabwean culture was so great. And I got really into Zimbabwean music. I did like a proper deep dive. And you know, the guys also, like throughout the film, they just burst into song at, you know, whenever they feel joy, whenever they feel sadness, whatever emotion, it's like the music is how they communicate and also how they connect as a team. And when I started to see that, I thought, gosh, we've really got to do the music justice here, because really music embodies all of who these guys are. And more than that, the film goes on this incredible journey, and I just really wanted the music to support it.
Yeah, I think I heard some instrument that's from the area and the culture. Did you sort of, was that part of your research, and how did you incorporate all those instruments into the score?
It was a really interesting process, because I'm not of African heritage. And it was really important to myself and also the two directors, Rob Coe and Warwick Ross, that we didn't try to imitate African music. So the approach was we create a classic film score with piano and strings and mallets and things like that, which give it that playfulness. But at the same time, incorporate into there some kind of element from the culture. So in this case, it was mbira, which is like a little kind of metallic kind of instrument. And I think that was the key. It was like bringing in some traditional instruments, but at the same time, using them in a very non African traditional way. And that was how we kind of navigated that and made sure that we were dealing with, African music really sensitively. I guess most importantly, and what we're really proud of as well, is that I was the music supervisor on the project too. And together with the directors, we sourced some amazing African music, specifically a lot of Zimbabwean and South African music, which we licensed and synced in the film. And it was great. Some of it's kind of well-known music from the region, and others are kind of unknown kind of artists who we uncovered and who we've featured. And you know, working as a music supervisor on other projects, often you're dealing with publishers and labels, doing all the negotiation of licensing the music. But in this case, a lot of the time I was, you know, talking directly to the artist who's based in Zimbabwe or Nigeria or South Africa. And that was really special, you know, getting to engage directly with these incredible artists and being able to tell them how much I love their music.
Yeah, so like in this project, I believe also for Unseen Skies, you play both the role of composer and music supervisor. And I guess that's just two facets of music for the screen. How do you What was your experience like for being the music supervisor as well?
Being a music supervisor on a project where you're also the composer has a lot of benefits. You know, like if you're responsible for sourcing a lot of the licensed music that's going to be in there and you're doing that from very early on in the process, often before, you know, you start composing, that helps make sure that the music that's being licensed as well as the music that's being composed for the score is going to work really well together. So I think it worked really well. And especially, you know, if we had a music brief in mind for the score for a particular project, the music that I'm sourcing to license to put in there as well is going to be, have that in mind, whatever that music brief is, so that it's all going to work cohesively together. So I think in a lot of ways it works really well. Nowadays I typically only really music supervise on projects that I'm composing on too. I think I kind of started with music supervision fairly early on before I was doing anything big composing wise. And I think I kind of saw it a bit as a way in terms of, you know, meeting directors, meeting producers. And it kind of worked out that way. Unseen Skies, I actually started off with doing some licensing work for the producer 3, 4, maybe 5 years ago, I think. Eventually he said, two projects in of doing music supervision for him, he said, why don't you have a go at working on this small doco series? And that's kind of how I got my first break as a composer, and really it was off the back of doing some music supervision work. So yeah, I'd certainly recommend that as an avenue if anybody is interested in the business side of music, which I'm semi interested in.
Yeah, well, I guess everyone's story is different, and how we start out and how we continue our journey as a composer. There's typically another avenue as an emerging composer as well. And I think music supervising, you're already in the industry, you're dealing with the filmmakers that you're going to be working with. So, it's definitely a great way to...
There is a risk of kind of being pigeonholed as a music supervisor. And I think, you know, it's kind of a double-edged sword. And I certainly experienced that a bit too. It's kind of hard to leap over into saying, oh, now I'm a composer.
I'm a composer as well, you know. That's...
I know. So, you know, some of the time it worked out, some of the time it didn't, but got there in the end.
I think that kind of works as well as like sound designer or movie editor. Like that could also lead to further roles of being a composer of the crew, because you're already part of the crew.
I worked also as a producer at a sound house called Uncanny Valley, and they were amazing and they continue to remain my close friends. But they were incredible. You know, I started with them. I didn't really have much composing experience, but we started kind of getting some long form projects through the door, like Channel 7 shows, Channel 10 shows and stuff like that. And they needed composers on deck, like all hands on deck. So they asked if I wanted to get involved, and I started composing. I was simply kind of there. It was a bit of right place, right time, I think. And they were so generous with teaching me the ropes. So I think that also helped get, you know, those initial credits, which I think are really hard to get. It's like you're doing a lot of short films, and it's really hard to go from short films into doing something that's on TV or in cinemas. And you kind of need someone to give you a go. And, you know, I hope to be able to give people a go and give back a bit, you know, as I get along as well, because I have a lot of people to thank for, you know, taking a punt and trying me out.
Meeting the right people, be at places where it needs to be, Yeah, it's amazing. Do you have any other advice for composers that are just starting out or looking for work? Is there any general advice you'd like to give?
Yeah. I mean, first and foremost, work on your craft. Like, I was, you know, I finished uni and went to Japan, came back, and I spent probably a good year of just finding short films. In my spare time on weekends, I'd just find them online, you know, strip out all the music. There'd be no dialogue or anything, but I'd just rewrite all of the music, you know. And I probably did that to 50 short films just in my spare time, never showed them to anybody, just to get better. I really wanted to get better at my production skills, because I just didn't, I felt like I was behind, you know. I didn't feel like I was as good as some other people who I was mixing with at that. So I was taking like electronic bangers that are on the radio and like literally kind of trying to recreate them. Like I'd take a Calvin Harris track and put it into Pro Tools version and like try to recreate every single synth line, put it all together and try to make it sound exactly like how Calvin Harris made it sound. And that stuff I feel really helped. And that was just me sitting by myself, like in my room, kind of doing it on weekends like a nerd. and I used to go to the movies and watch a movie and then go home and write a 2-page kind of description and analysis of the music that was in the movie. And I just think all of that helps. You know, I never look at it again. I've never listened to those short films that I did again. I've never looked at, you know, all that stuff that I wrote after seeing movies. But I think, you know, just actively thinking about it with everything that you watch, really analyzing anything that you watch on TV, any ad you watch that has music, just listen to it and think about, you know, do I like it, do I not? But then why don't I like it? Why do I like it? What's cool about it? And just having that critical mind, I think, just helps you grow. And, you know, anytime you can get, just practicing on whatever door you use, just kind of getting really familiar with it, trying different ones. And yeah, I mean, like tutorials on mixing and production. Nowadays, I mean, you don't have a mixer who's kind of standing by, who's going to mix all of your music beautifully. What you do is typically what ends up on screen. So getting really good, getting really efficient with how to use the stuff, investing in some good plugins that are going to make your music sound good means that, you know, you can compose the most beautiful music on the planet, but if you know, you've got terrible sounding brass instruments and, you know, crappy strings, and you don't have any mastering software to kind of pull it all together and, you know, make it sound kind of radio ready, it's not going to sound impressive to someone you're trying to show and kind of, you know, get someone to take a chance on you. And then once you feel like, you know, you've done a bunch of practice, just don't be shy, reach out to people, you know. Like I've had composers reach out to me who are a bit younger, who want to know some things and who want some opportunities, and I've tried to give them opportunities, and a lot of people are like that and really generous with their time. And, you know, I think as composers, we tend to operate as silos sometimes. We're in, you know, studios without windows, working by ourselves. And, and I think we've got to get out there and, you know, meet other people in the community. Contact the sound houses in your area, because they're often looking for composers. If they can give you one shot on one show they're working on, take that shot, and you never know, you know, when they're going to need you again. And so, yeah, I think don't be afraid. Get out there and just contact as many people as possible, and something will someone will give you a go.
Yeah, wow, that's some amazing advice. Very useful. Thank you, Helena. I guess there's another question that what I want to ask is that, you know, for a modern composer working for screen, how important do you think having that classical background is nowadays, since we're kind of going towards the direction of minimalist music or sound design incorporated? How do you feel about the importance of knowing the music theory and as such?
It's a really good question, Luna. And it's something that I think about often. I mean, I meet composers who come from totally, you know, all different backgrounds, and you know, we all kind of approach music in a different way, and I think that's what makes us all unique and different. I came from a kind of classical theory heavy background, but I was scared of performing, like really scared of performing in front of anybody. And I was always really self-conscious about that because I thought, gosh, how can I be a composer if I can't play in front of anybody?
The same. Yeah, classically trained, but can't improvise for anything.
It terrifies me. So, you know, I think... We've all got some background that has led us to where we are. For me, it was I loved music, and I was a bit of a theory nerd, actually. I loved the theory behind music, but I was scared of performing, and I thought, how am I, you know, I love music. How's this going to work? And then I found composing. So, you know, that's something that I can do and that I love, and I'm able to use my creative side and you know, collaborate with people, and I just love that world. But honestly, I mean, I don't know that it really matters whether you come from classical background or not. People will come to you for what you do. So if you're a guitarist and you come from a jazz guitar background, for instance, and you're not a classical person, people will come to you for what you do best. So for me, I think people come to me for, you know, obviously I can do the orchestration stuff, but the type of kind of projects that I typically work on aren't full orchestral. It's like combining electronic sounds with acoustic sounds or warping acoustic sounds in interesting ways. And I guess because I've done a lot of that stuff and that's kind of my happy place, people listen to what I've done before and come back for more of that, but approach it in a different way for the project. So I think it doesn't matter. And in terms of where music's headed, it is headed into that kind of sound design electronic world more and more, which I love. And yeah, I don't know, maybe the next year of work I may not use a live instrument again if that's what the projects call for, because it's kind of where things are headed a lot of the time. So it really depends. I mean, for me, it's about like I like to understand instruments as well as possible. I like to know how they work. I finished uni and then did an online orchestration course with Berkeley, just because I you know, I felt like I wanted more skills in that. So what I would say, if you don't come from a classical background, totally fine. Use that to your advantage. Wherever you come from, whatever you enjoy, use that as the thing that distinguishes you from everybody else. But also, I think it would be wise for you to expand your toolbox, and if you have the opportunity to learn some orchestration or to, you know, learn about how a violin works, learn different extended techniques on different instruments and all of that, undoubtedly that will come in handy at some point. Because, like, you know, directors come at you and they say, hey, I want trumpet in this thing. Can you put a trumpet in there? And you kind of have to put a trumpet in there. So, yeah. You know, I think the more you know, the better.
Yeah. Okay. So it's not going to be super exclusive, but the more the merrier when it comes to it honing your skills. And
yeah, just be curious, you know, be curious about different instruments, different ways of treating instruments and sounds, and have a play. And I think as long as you're curious and as long as you're willing to kind of expand your knowledge, you know, it'll come in handy.
Yeah, just like Steve Jobs says, stay hungry, stay foolish.
Yes, exactly.
I think I've got one last question. As we're both female composers and, you know, our AGSC or filmmaking industry is being very aware of the gender equality, and there are a lot of events. What's your view on that, or how do you feel about being a female composer or filmmaker in the industry?
I've actually had really good experiences in this industry being a female composer. I think very rarely do I feel like my gender really comes into the work that I do and whether I get a job or whether I don't get a job. But I mean, there's undoubtedly an imbalance in how many female composers there are and how many male composers there are. I did a lunch, like a virtual lunch for Tribeca Film Festival. For me, it was at like 3 a.m. in the morning. But I went to this virtual lunch and it was full of all of the composers who had films at Tribeca. And there would have been about 60 composers as part of this virtual lunch, and only about 4 were women. So it was very unbalanced, and that's kind of a global film festival. So that's pretty indicative, I guess, of where we're at in terms of the balance. I mean, and my experience of being at the con as well, you know, there were, I think, about 13 of us in our year and only 3 of us were girls. So I think it starts back at, you know, back at school, tertiary level. You know, I think if there are only, if there are far fewer girls who are kind of interested and getting into these kind of institutions, we can't expect to have a balance, you know, in the professional kind of sphere. So I imagine that things are changing in schools and in unis as well. And girls are kind of becoming more aware of composing as a viable career path. And, you know, I'm a huge champion of girls doing great things. And I think, I love helping girls kind of learn the ropes a bit. My experience was also that I felt like at school there wasn't really any emphasis on learning technology and learning kind of how important technology, computers, doors, synths and plugins and all that are to being a working composer nowadays, whereas I feel like I got to uni and a lot of the guys just kind of knew it all already. And I was a bit kind of on the back foot. And so I had to do a lot of extra work to catch up with all of that and learn how does a mic work, how does, you know. And so I don't know whether that's because, you know, I wasn't taught that stuff early on, or whether I just didn't have an interest in it and they had a keener interest in it from a very early age. But I did feel like that was a difference that I hope is kind of in schools and unis being dealt with a bit better.
Yeah, that's very interesting. I never really thought about it that way, where guys are more into techie things than girls a lot of the time, and that kind of, there's a difference between that as well, I guess, with production. We kind of have to hone our skills in that way and know how synths work, know how audio work in general. Oh, for sure.
Yeah, and I don't know whether it's just because they were exposed to it more as a, they had more, you know, people to look up to who had that as a career path. And, you know, for producers, it's electronic music producers, probably far fewer are female than
that's very true.
Film composers, you know. Yeah. It's even more so a kind of balance issue. So yeah, I think things are changing. You know, we've got Hilda, who is so amazing, and she's, you know,
got us an Oscar.
Yeah, I think people are kind of waking up to the fact that we can do anything as well. We can do it.
Why not?
And there's no distinction anymore, I don't think. I mean, I think now it's just a matter of, you know, younger people who are interested in music. If it's a girl, they know that this is a viable career path and they can kind of pursue that. And yeah, I think the Guild is doing amazing work with making sure that female film composers are visible and can be the kind of people that younger composers can look up to and can aspire to be and hopefully reach out to for advice as well. So yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure there are little girls are watching this video and say, I want to be Helena one day.
Be your own version. Find your own little niche.
I'll try to write every synth line from NASA sample and then I'll go do my own thing.
That's right, I know. I'll give you the NASA library and you can just go for your life.
Yes, it's a pleasure having you, Helena. Yeah, thank you so much for all the great advice for composers.
Thanks so much for having me. It's exciting.